SRE team spent 20 to 40% of their time managing observability infrastructure. My name is Paul Nashawaty, and I'm the practice lead for the AppDev practice at theCUBE Research. And I'm joined today by Nishant from Last9. Nishant, would you like to introduce yourself?
Thanks, Paul, for having me on the show. Great to chat with you. I'm Nishant. I'm the founder CEO at Last9, where we're building a high-cardinality observability platform. I started on the journey essentially with a very interesting question that was posed to by a team member of mine to said, could you build a self-driving car with a 140-pixel camera? And I think that's fascinating to think about because really modern observability is no different than having high-fidelity cameras, be able to understand what system is doing in a 360-degree way and have those feedback loops, feedback in real time to the automation we can do to not just have better resiliency, but reliability for our businesses across.
Well, I'm excited to have you here because this is definitely a hot topic, right? I mean, whether it's organizations early in their maturity curve or very well mature, organizations are looking to build and use reliable tools for their cyber reliability engineering and DevOps teams. They're really looking to understand time-sensitive or time-series data stores and really to optimize those observability at scale, right? Because this is what we're talking about, Sean. It's like the core goal here is to reduce the toil, the cost, the complexities, and management of the metrics across the infrastructure. Use tools like, Prometheus and Datadog, but also maintaining that high availability of performance and production for those production systems. So Nishant, like when we look at this, there's a lot happening with observability. I know we can go in 1,000 directions here. So I really want to focus in on a couple of areas, right? We're seeing how organizations are unable to keep up with data growth and volume. And we see telemetry data growing at 30% year to year. And we see there's a struggling with high cardinality workloads within observability. What are your thoughts here? And how do you think organizations can overcome some of these challenges?
You make a great point, Paul, right? Because telemetry is growing at about 30% CAGR and isn't slowing down anytime soon. What we've found is a very interesting dynamic across teams where developers and software engineers want to be able to send in more data, but there is undue pressure on platform teams to either face the toil necessary to manage that high dimensionality, high cardinality data, or actually not have it observed at all, which obviously creates different challenges in the context of how much coverage of data exists, what blind spots do we have when managing and running these systems, and being able to have those full-proof coverage in a way that you can feed it back into the automation that's driving it. We're tracking such data across thousands of containers that spin up and down, leading to different cardinality workloads. It's really important to be able to think this through at a data platform layer and not just at an application layer to make sure that all of the data is getting shipped correctly.
Yeah, Nishant, it's amazing to me in our own research, at theCUBE research, we find that 75% of respondents are actually using 6 to 15 different observability tools. And this was a study across over 840 plus respondents on an NCAL global study. So there's a lot of different tools out there. There's a lot of different ways to collect the information. And then when we look at it, about 52% of the organizations are looking at reducing those tools, right? And trying to go with more of a focused across this for their specific use case, but want more of a, it's kind of a weird thing. They want a bespoke solution for the specific functions that they're looking at, but they also want a unified view so they could take actionable insights. And I guess this is part of that growth and maturity that we were talking about, right? And so Nishant, I want to kind of bring it back to, when we talk about these different tools, data is siloed and really spread across multiple sources, right? You have a variety of data that's hitting, multi-cloud. We see that distributed cloud, 94% of organizations are using two or more, 65% are using four or more clouds. We see that applications are across the core, the edge, the cloud, in all various places. So same telemetry data is going through different tools and for different use cases, and they're unable to really harmonize across the metrics, the logs, the tracing and events. And it really becomes those siloed, monolithic views of this information that becomes very challenging with organizations, especially when it comes to overall TCO and complexity issues. I'd love to hear your thoughts around how organizations can kind of harmonize this.
Yeah, I think that's a very interesting point, especially across data silos and how the observability landscape has emerged over many years, whether it is for infrastructure monitoring, application monitoring. But if you think about it, fundamentally, these are artificial boundaries that have been created for very specific business reasons and less so real patterns of usage. They are, at the end of the day, logs, metric trace, and event data at the telemetry layer, which means people and organizations want to be able to correlate it across. As I mentioned earlier, telemetry has the same characteristics of challenges as volume, variety, and velocity, which means you really need an approach where you're not just mapping that variety of data across data silos into a unified schema of your own definition that empowers not just developers and SREs, but multiple personas across organizations to leverage that operational data in a much more effective way. I think it's a fascinating time, especially with the automation needs across these companies, where a converged telemetry platform, if you will, is probably where it's progressing very rapidly. What Grafana solved in a big way was the unification of the UI layer. But I think the fundamental data silos are going to create a further barrier for correlation, data unification, and the schema that you can have to define your own attributes and leverage them downstream. It's no longer important just to have corralled panels all together on a dashboard. It's important for the data to speak for itself as a unified story that UI just represents it in a much more elegant way.
Well, I mean, I would say fascinating times indeed. I mean, there's definitely a lot happening here. What you were mentioning about the dashboard views, kind of snapping dashboards together, that's not exactly the integration, so to speak. That's a view. That's a good view. And, you know, I really hate the term single pane of glass, because there's never a single pane of glass, as you know, and anybody watching this video knows. But the reality of it is you hit on a couple of things, and I'm gonna kind of unpack it a little bit here. When we look at automation, right? Automation is an area that goes across the stack, right? It's when I think of observability, I'm looking at it and with the lens of the application logic. I'm looking at it from the infrastructure up, right? I'm looking at it what happens in the context of day zero, day one, day two, across the CI/CD pipeline, across the SDLC. But that's only a small part of observability, right? You have AI ops in the infrastructure side. You have data observability that comes in from the data sets that feeds those applications. So all these elements of observability are really areas that really need to have their own areas to be unpacked, which is one of the things that we're doing later this year. Is we're doing an observability summit that we're really excited about. So that will be interesting to think about. But I think, Nishant, when I think about the TCO play here, and we think about all those different elements, budgets are not increasing, right? Actually, what we see is there's already an average spending 15 to 20% on cloud budget for observability, just cloud budget for observability, not to mention the infrastructure or the data or whatever it needs, whatever else that's out there. But there needs to be a predictable cost despite all this growth that's happened. Right. And I think that cost needs to be harmonized and probably, dare I say, known upfront before the project starts, versus looking at having the, oh no, this happened, I don't know what to do now, I've overspent. And, you know, usually what happens from the IT perspective, the IT leadership will go back to the SREs or the DevOps teams and say, hey, what did you overspend on? They go, look, we over-provisioned because we want to make sure that we're doing what we need to do. But the reality of it is there's a budget in place. What are your thoughts here?
That's fascinating. It's always an interesting point in terms of any enterprise tooling to have almost a governance structure as well, right? To be able to visualize, understand where your data is going, how do you spend about it. I think partly the observability economics challenge has been twofold. One, like we mentioned earlier, the data volume growth, but partly also because a lot of this tooling that has emerged don't give the users necessary control to shape the data that they actually need, which means they're locked into the vendor's view of the world without really having the visibility necessary. in terms of shaping that data, either filtering it, enriching it, dropping it based on the suggestions or intelligence of the platform itself that it can drive to make sure the data can be optimized for downstream usage. I think the second part about that is almost, how would I say, meta visibility or meta observability, to understand which applications, which teams, which services, what infrastructure or geography or availability zones are sending you more data versus other. More often than not, I've heard platform teams complain about they did not change a thing, but over the weekend came back to a 20% higher bill just because something from the observability vendor did not add up in the cardinality context. I think two critical points have emerged where, one, you need to be able to give control back to the users in a way that they get to define and shape their data for what's important to them so that they get charged for what they care for. I think that's been a big missing ground with traditional observability class. And the second is in terms of the recommendations that the platform itself drives in terms of use cases, and obviously the billing model in terms of making it as a unified platform rather than charging for use cases. I think those are just some of the initial areas for obviously a lot needs to be done as an industry. One big part of this obviously is the rise of open telemetry, which itself helps unbox and unpack the entire observability stack. And it's going to be fascinating to observe that play out.
Yeah, no doubt. Actually, there's two things I want to touch on that you brought up here. One is I'll touch on the latter point that you just made, which is open telemetry and OTel and such. And you know what we see in our research is 67% of organizations are really looking to utilize open source initiatives, open source projects, but they don't want to go at it alone. They want to work with vendors that have enterprise level support because they don't have that, the organization doesn't have that bench strength in order to support that. And frankly, to build it yourself, to, you know, the DIY, to build it yourself, the devils are in the details. Once you build it, you own it. And if something goes wrong, you need to fix it. So having, you know, enterprise level support and enterprise level commitment, you understand what is working there and also how to improve the process with the details that need to be implemented. So that's one piece. The other thing I wanted to touch on was, you know, again, it comes back to the maturity, where the organizations live within the cycle, right? Because, you know, I think that you were talking about observability teams will go away for the weekend, come back, and then all of a sudden they have a lot of, you know, an increase of storage. You know, I used to make the joke, and I kind of still do, that a lot of observability teams are basically storage admins, right? Because they just collect a bunch of data and they don't know how to process the information. And that's where the actionable insights really come into play. That's where the maturity kind of grows with the observability practices and such. So, you know, I know that there's a lot here to think about. There's definitely a lot to think about when it comes to, and you know, and I also want to say, we haven't even talked about AI, and I can't believe we had a session with that. We don't even talk about AI. So there's definitely a lot here to talk about. But before we wrap up here, I'd love to give you, Nishant, the final thought. What do you think? I mean, we talked about a lot here. There's a lot to unpack. Where can the audience go to learn more about this?
I think the observability landscape is at an interesting inflection point. The explosion of data isn't going to slow down, like we mentioned. Comprehensive visibility is only going to get more critical. And like you mentioned, we haven't spoken even about intelligence, but across not just collecting data, but actually processing it, automatically extracting meaningful insights is going to be fascinating. Obviously, at Last9, we're working hard towards a world where observability largely manages itself, adapting to changing workloads and proactively identifying issues. Most of the audience in this community can go to last9.io to learn more about it. But independent of this, while it's always great to learn from the community itself, and participate and learn more of them.
Nishant, it's been really great having you on. I mean, the insights here are, you know, are very important, especially for organizations trying to start their own journeys. I want to thank you for being our guest on today, on today's episode. I also want to give a big thanks to all of you for tuning in. We appreciate you being part of the AppDevANGLE community. With that, it wraps up this episode, and we'll be back next Wednesday with another conversation diving into the tools, trends, and talent shaping the future of application development. Whether you're deploying at the edge, building with AI, modernizing your cloud stack, we've got you covered. Be sure to follow us on social. If you have any thoughts, questions, or just want to connect, you can always reach me at paulnn@siliconangle.com. Until next time, stay curious and stay building.